always a joy for us to be with you, and especially this time of the year in our country and around the world where we celebrate the death and the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. We welcome you and we pray that this time your life will be so tuned to God and you will be closer drawn to Him. So we invite you to stay tuned and we ask that you invite someone. Let them know the choices is on. God bless you.
This evening we want to continue our discussion we started on the value of human life. And we want to say from the inception that the birth of Jesus Christ was not his beginning. The scripture is very clear in Revelation 13. It says the Lamb was slain before the foundation of the world. And we want to draw your attention to 1 Corinthians 15 and 3, which says, the Apostle Paul rightly says, for what I received, I passed on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures. So the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ have tremendous implications for all mankind. It speaks about Christ moving mankind from death into life, into prosperity, into victory. And therefore, central to the whole notion of this particular way that we're talking about, the followers of Christ, is the whole notion of the resurrection. Because the resurrection speaks of one being able to grow, one being able to expand, and being able to enjoy eternal life. And that's why the Apostle Paul said, it's very clear when he said, if this resurrection, you know, had not taken place, we might as well eat, drink, be merry, for tomorrow we die. But we are alive and we believe by faith that Jesus Christ rose from the dead because we want to enjoy this eternal life. And so we want to present the value of human life.
In our 21st century world, as we attempt to process the impact of his death, his burial, and his resurrection, very important for us to consider those concepts. I'm bemused by some people who say they never sin. they're not in agreement with the concept of sin. So they believe that this concept of sin, because they don't agree with it, there's no need for a savior. And therefore, salvation is irrelevant. The scripture is clear and that Christ died for our sins. Very, very clear that his life, his death was a sacrificial, a superior sacrifice for our sins. And this is not a Jewish thing. Another point I'd like to make. It cannot be restricted to that geographical location. That was never the intent of God in the beginning. Yeah. This plan was universal. Yes, for you. You may not look like it, but he died for you. I don't care who you look like, what you look like, which religion you're from. Christ died for our sins. Listen, this is comforting, that you and I don't have to negotiate life on our own. You and I don't have to generate help to negotiate life. Christ died for our sins. And here, this wasn't done in a corner. The scripture says in 1 Corinthians 15, 4, and he was buried. He was buried. There are some credible sites, two credible sites of his burial in Jerusalem. I went to both. I went into one of the tombs, amazing scenes. And he was buried. And he rose again the third day according to the scriptures. And that he was seen of Cephas, then of the 12. What a community witness, not just to his disciples, not just to his close men, but to the community. He was seen above 500 brethren at once. Could you imagine this? In the Caribbean, we have a concept of Jambi, Laja Bless, and those kinds of things. You could imagine people seeing their relative after they buried him walking in the street again. Usain's record of being under serious threat. You know, his people would run. But we have to understand seriously that he, I like to make the point that Lazarus was not resurrected.
No. Yeah.
Lazarus was resuscitated because he died again.
Yes.
Jesus is the first fruit. Jesus was resurrected.
Yes.
Jesus will never die again. That's the power of the resurrection. And that's a distinction that's so critical for us to make. So he was seen of James. He was seen of Thomas, a doubter. And Paul said, he was seen of me. And you know what? You can also see him.
That is so awesome. Jesus will never die again. And so are many of us who have accepted this Jesus Christ as our Savior. Listen to me, you who have never sinned, that is an instrument, or that is a statement of your own intent. That is of the law. It's a set thing that you might have set yourself and say, that I have never done this, I've never done that, I've never done that. That is the righteousness that was made by the law. And I have a rag in my pocket, but I will save you the agony. But I tell you, if I blew my nose in it, I will not wipe my face with it. Because that is like your righteousness. It's like filthy rags. But I want you to know that there is a righteousness that is of Christ. And this righteousness is for the believer, those of us who believe in him. And for this Easter season, I would love you to know him in the power of the resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering. And your life will be defined in Christ as you go along. We are existing right here, right now, with resurrection power.
You know the whole concept of you made reference to the community witness. And I'm thinking of the pre-dawn experience and occurrence that took place at the gravesite on that Sabbath night going into the first day of the week morning, as Mary and Magdalene are on their way to the tomb. The word of God says that an angel descended. And there was an earthquake. And as he sat on the tomb, his raiment was white. And those platoon guards, they became like dead men. Now, what I notice here is that the angel had no communication with these guards. But as Mary and Magdalene got there, he said, "Don't be afraid. Do not be afraid. He's risen. He's alive and well." They got a witness of what took place. But look at the guards, astonished by this disturbance, not knowing what to do. And it takes me back to what happened when Paul and Silas were in chains, and they sang and they worshiped, and the chains fell from them. That was a witness to the guards there. Those guards there made a responsible decision to embrace Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of their lives. Those are the guards at the tomb site who got a witness of them of what took place. They became as dead men. They did nothing. They had an opportunity to come into a closer walk with Jesus Christ.
Well, you know, what you're saying begs some explanation. Mm-hmm. The Roman guards and the Roman mindset, they had their own pantheon of gods.
Mm-hmm.
And they found it amusing that this Jew was talking about Jehovah and his father. It was laughable to them because Caesar was God.
Yeah.
And he was divine. And who is this rabble-rouser?
Mm-hmm.
talking about the way to God. I mean, the centurion, when Jesus is on the cross, the centurion, they were kind of looking at with scorn and probably sympathetic. But the centurion, when Jesus was crucified and the earth became dark and there was an earthquake, that man uttered involuntarily a statement when he said, "Truly, this is the Son of God."
Yes.
Now, this is not fresh doctrine. He, all is the sum total of his knowledge, came to that place. All these things are, nature is subject to this. Nature is subject to him. And he heard that voice. "It is finished." The Roman mind is trying to process all this information. What meaning this? Now, when Matthew describes those guards at the tomb, those guys were well-trained. I mean, it's, people in our 21st century were thinking about security guard. Listen, there's not no old man, an old lady with some piece of wood and a radio, you know, and a flask. No. These were crack Praetorian guards. These people were trained to kill. They were not afraid of anything. They conquered the world. They were proud of their status. But they couldn't understand that force that they witnessed that night. The power and the authority of God. And so they froze. No. It's no small wonder. When they left there, they were shell-shocked. They went to the priest in an attempt. These Romans went down to the Sanhedrin, these people, and say, "Man, what really happened there?" They told them the story. They were looking for meaning, looking for understanding. What happened here last night? Mm-hmm. And the Sanhedrin, those vagabonds, we mustn't speak evil of dignitaries and so on. But they remained who they were. They decided to bribe these guys. These people were searching for help, and they end up being bribed.
Yeah.
I mean, this certainly that's not a template of well-trained soldiers. Well-trained soldiers would have gone to their superiors. But these guys were looking for spiritual help.
Yeah.
And they got bondage instead, because the Sanhedrin and the religious leaders, they were always at odds with Jesus. But you know what I am blessed by? He's no longer in the tomb.
Oh, yes.
He's risen. And he didn't come out of that tomb for the Jews or for the Sanhedrin only. He came out for all of us.
Yes.
All of us.
You know, you can't cover up truth. At some point in time, the truth will get out. It has to burst forth. Because it is the truth that will set people free. And so we talked about Jesus, the lamb slain before the foundation of the earth, the foundation of the world. And there are many of you who might be, around this time, you might be watching a Jesus movie, whether it is The Passion of the Christ, Jesus of Nazareth, or whatever, and you sit there watching and you're feeling sorry, based upon what you're seeing, and say, "Oh, look what they did to him. And, look the beatings, and look the bloodshed, and the nailing, and so on." But these things were all prophesied in Isaiah 53, spoke about he was wounded for our transgressions, bruised for our iniquities, the chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. So the whole thing about Jesus and his crucifixion, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus, it is not a tragedy. It is something that Jesus determined that he will do, that he will shed his blood, so creating that atonement for man's sins, causing that gap, that bridge, to bridge that gap between God and man again. So it is not a tragedy. He wasn't murdered. The high priest Caiaphas didn't kill Jesus. Pilate didn't pronounce on Jesus' death. And all the others who shouted crucify him, they had nothing to do with Jesus' death, as for that matter. Jesus already was part of a master plan for the salvation of mankind. Amen. And nothing could have stopped that plan. And that's why the scripture clearly says he set his face as a flint on the road to Jerusalem. Jesus didn't look to the left or right. I remember there was a situation when the women were crying and somebody attempted to, you know, go to him, and Jesus said, "Woman, weep for yourself." Mm-hmm. You know, so this is not a tragedy. It wasn't no big murder scene. It was Jesus who said, "I am the good shepherd. I lay my life down and I could pick it up again. Destroy this body and in 3 days I will pick it up again so that you could have victory."
Preacher, the resurrection was the fountainhead mm-hmm. of events, event after event after event. Mark chapter 7 captures the kind of animosity, the intense dialogue that resulted in animosity between Jesus and the Pharisees. Let's look at this. That's why they were out to get him, really out to get him. They came together unto him, the Pharisees, and certain of the scribes, which came from Jerusalem. And when they saw some of his disciples eat bread with defiled, that is to say, with unwashed hands, they found fault. The Pharisees said that you're not supposed to eat without washing your hands. For the Pharisees and all the Jews, except they wash their hands often, eat not, holding the tradition of the elders. This is the clash, ladies and gentlemen, between the tradition of the elders and the truth of the kingdom. Jesus represented the truth of the kingdom. And when they come forth from the market, except they wash, they eat not, and many other things they be, which they have received to hold as the washing of cups and pots, brazen vessels and of tables. Then the Pharisees and the scribes ask him, "Why walk not thy disciples according to the tradition of the elders, but eat bread with unwashed hands?" And Jesus answered and said unto them, "Well, had Isaiah prophesied of you hypocrites, as it is written, 'This people honored me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. They wash in the outside, but their heart is far from me. Howbeit, in vain do they worship me, teaching her for doctrines the commandments of men. You have the commandments of God, but these scribes and Pharisees prefer to teach the commandments of men. For laying aside the commandment of God, ye hold the traditions of men, as the washing of pots and cups, and many other such like things ye do." And he said unto them, "Full well you reject the commandment of God, that you may keep your own tradition." This is done in public. Mm-hmm. Jesus is confronting a worldview that said, there is no sin, there's no God, you don't need to be forgiven. You shouldn't teach children about Christ in schools and all of those kinds of things. Jesus is confronting all of these philosophical concepts. And he said to them, "For Moses said, honor thy father and thy mother, and whoso curseth father or mother, let him die the death. But you say, if a man shall say to his father or mother, it is korban," meaning it is a gift, "by whatsoever thou mightest be profited by me, he shall be free." These guys invented a system that if a man determined, Moses said, you must honor your father, your mother. They invented a system that said, if you get tired of that, there's a way out. Jesus said to them, "And you suffer him no more to do aught for his father or his mother, making the word of God of none effect through your tradition, which you have delivered, and many such like things do ye." And when he had called all the people unto them, he said, "You know, hearken unto me, every one of you, and understand." Now, Jesus, the classical clash between Jesus and the Pharisees and the scribes and the religious elders. They were waiting for this day. They were able to influence Judas to do what he did. He was betrayed. But again, Jesus was not a victim. Don't ever see Jesus as a victim. Jesus illustrated something in his life, that the enemies of the last or the old move, the former move, those people, the leaders of the last or the former move, they become the enemies of the ideas of the new move. And so God sent Jesus to present to the world the principles of the kingdom of God. And the moment he announced his mission, he was marked for death. But he was not afraid, because the scripture, same scripture said, he was a lamb slain from the foundation of the world. So he came to die, that you and I might have life, and that more abundantly. So irrespective of their ethnicity, that's why we have a compulsion to tell all mankind about Jesus Christ, about his love. And this is not disrespecting anybody. It is our duty to let men know Jesus Christ is alive.
Yes.
And he came to set us free.
That's he is so alive. And he is alive and well. And this very book that we believe, this Bible, says in John 21 and 25, it says, Jesus did many other things that are not written in the Bible, as some people from other religious persuasions would say. It's not written in the book. But what is written? These are written so that men might believe. And believing, you might have life through his name. Are you prepared to believe? I want to warn you that if you believe not, we all know John 3:16 and we love it. Since, you know, from the time we are children, we have learned to repeat it. God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son. But if we continue to read on, to go to 17 and 18, if we believe not, we already condemn. So don't let your unbelief condemn you.
I want
serve
to say,
Jesus.
I want to say, this same spirit that raised Jesus Christ from the dead. I want to say, Spirit, the same power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead and picked your mortal body,
amen,
can resurrect your mortal body, can heal your mortal body. I am a testimony of the power of God. We are a testimony of the power of God. His transforming power, his healing power. You know, quite recently, from the image of quite recently, I met a woman about two Wednesday nights ago, right in the door when the service was finished. And she said to me, Pastor, I don't want publicity. I really don't want any big show, but I want to tell you, I want to testify, I want to tell you something. Bible study was finished some time back, and as you were going through the door, you stopped me. No, I stopped you and asked you to pray for my daughter. And you asked, what is wrong with my daughter? And I told you that my daughter was sick in her feet and in her hands, and that the doctors first didn't quite know what was the reason, and then they finally found what was the cause and said to me that she would never walk nor use her hands again. And you call another pastor, and the person she described seemed to be either Pastor Simple or Pastor Paul, and you laid hands on her and you prayed, laid hands on me and prayed for her. And I want to let you know that that girl is walking and she's using her hands and everything is normal. The same young lady who doctor said that she cannot walk or use her hands again. I want you to know it is that same resurrection power that has done that. And there's scores of testimony that of stories like that. Therefore, invite that resurrection power.
Some people believe that Lazarus, the one who Jesus called from the graveyard, when he said, Lazarus, come forth, that Lazarus was resurrected. That was a good friend of Jesus. No, Lazarus was simply resuscitated. He died again.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus was the first fruit of the resurrection. He will never die again. He was raised by the power of God. I would like us to reflect on this. Paul, writing to the church at Ephesus in chapter 1 of Ephesians, verse 19, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power towards us who believe, You know, if you believe, right where you are, raise your hand. Yeah, you. The other hand, not the one with the beer. Yeah. The other towards us who believe, according to the power of his mighty power, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead. This is not Ludlum. This is the Word of God. We have a description of how God raised Christ from the dead. And not just raise him from the dead and say, finish. No, no, no. In the spiritual realm, listen to this testimony. He set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places. So he has been exalted to the right hand of his Father. Ladies and gentlemen, wherever you view this, you're viewing this program, or that you're viewing this program during this choice Easter season, or you're viewing it 5 months from now, this word is true. Christ has been placed far above principality. There's some people who are at work, and you wonder why is it you're having the kinds of troubles that you have. There are others who have gone, and they have dabbled in iniquity. This is not only at work, but at home, at university, and schools. You've seen all of these different things. But we are confident that we can negotiate this life in the presence of those kinds of dangerous situations because Christ has been placed far above principality and far above power and far above might and far above dominion and far above every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come. And he has put all things under his feet and given him to be the head over all things to the church. Whoever you are, resurrection of Jesus Christ is not limited to kite flying. God has placed him far above. And because he has placed him far above, guess what he's doing? He's a mediator between God and you. Yes. Happy Easter. This is Choices. Be blessed.
We thank you for joining us on Choices today. Remember, you can join us at First Assembly, LNP Durban Street, Workmanville, Georgetown, Guyana, for any of our special services. I'm Salacia on behalf of the set, reminding you that your whole life is the sum of your choices. God bless you.